Hello, welcome to the first edition of Journalist Hangout this week. I am Dapo Aru Ajoye. Today on the program, a death toll rises to 139 in Zamfara attacks. Markafi's PDP faction calls for postponement of Ondo gubernatorial election. And later on the program, President Buhari begs militants to stop destroying pipelines. I'll be joined by Tabia Princewill, Afemi Odere, and Mojeed Jamiu. A Journalist Hangout starts now. In the last 2 weeks, Zamfara State has witnessed an unimaginable horror. A report saying more than 139 people have been slaughtered in cold blood by suspected Castro rustlers who took the campaign on terror to some communities there. The state police command confirmed that even policemen and a soldier among the victims. Again, women and children have been ruthlessly murdered by bloodthirsty mercenaries who parade themselves as cattle rustlers. But these vicious attacks don't only stop at killing these innocent Nigerians. A report also says more than 40 people have been kidnapped so far. But why were they kidnapped? There are indications that this government might want the state government to exchange the hostages for the cows security operatives recovered from them earlier this month. The state government has begun investigation into attacks. But we have a bigger problem in our hands. In August, the United Nations said there are more than 350 million illegal small arms and light weapons in Nigeria. How do we stop these kinds of attack? Tabia, good evening. I'd rather start with you. The ladies would say first. What is happening in this part of Nigeria? It's horror, really.
Yeah. Well, for me, it's a very sad situation because a lot of these problems, particularly the security issues that you find in the north of Nigeria, they've been 20, 30 years in the making. Mm. You know, things keep happening. Problems arise, but they're not dealt with when they first, you know, start to occur. And the situation just keeps getting worse and worse and worse. As we saw with Boko Haram, now we have issues with herdsmen and all that. Some whom the security forces say are not even Nigerians. Mm. But because of the paucity of our borders, you know, people travel in and out of Niger Republic, Chad, back and forth, you know, within Nigeria. And there seems to be no stopping them. But the question really is, for me, is the security agencies, you know, who gather intelligence or who are meant to gather intelligence, why does it seem that it is so difficult for them to act? You know, there have been situations where we've heard that there were calls coming from villages, for example, with the Boko Haram attacks, people saying these people are coming, but nothing is done. So I think we need to start from there first. Look at what is misfunctioning in our intelligence gathering, you know. It seems as if there are very few countries in the world where you will find attacks happening with such wanton abandon, and it seems as if
back to back.
No one can do anything, you know. The governors need to really go back to the drawing board and not just look at what the federal arm of government can do for them. They are the chief security operative of their state. You know, they should be able to tackle all of this so that lives aren't just lost for no real reason.
Hmm. Femi, what do you think also? Because sometimes you hear cattle rustlers, the other time you hear cattle rearers, a whole lot happened, violence everywhere.
Well, I would like to take it from the angle of the recent UN report. I don't know if you are aware of it. I think that came out about maybe two or three weeks ago, that Nigeria happens to be the third most terrorized country in the world.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
You would think that such a damning revelation, you know, will have triggered, you know, some very serious, you know, reaction, both on the part of the Nigerian people and on the part of government, most especially. But you look around our society, it is like nothing unimaginable is happening. It's like business as usual. Mm. I don't know why by now a state of emergency, you know, has not been declared. in the entire country. You know, maybe save the Southwest, but even the Southwest is not even immune, you know, from all these, you know, violence.
Attacks.
You know, because you deal with Boko Haram on one hand, you deal with the Niger Delta militants, you know, on another hand, and you're dealing with cattle rustlers, you know, on another hand, and you have to begin to ask yourself, where will all these, you know, when will all these stop? And it doesn't look as if, you know, we have a good cognizance of the amount of violence, you know, that is happening within our shores. Look at the statistics that the UN also gave, that 350 million illegal small arms and light weapons are available in Nigeria. What is our population? Our population is about what, 170, 160, and we don't even know the exact population.
So like two
anyway.
almost like two to one.
It's almost like 2 to 1, you know, person with illegal arms. Not to talk about the legal arms. You know, you look at the proliferation of all these weapons, and you have to, in any normal climate, that would have been a serious state of emergency, and that would have been a serious clampdown, and that would have been a serious shout from the citizenry that something must be done.
Mm-hmm. We'll definitely talk more about that because of recent, when they said the cultists in River State renounced, or what did they say to do now? They said they were not doing again. Mm. Apparently, do you know how many guns we saw the other day? And it's still in the same River State. The other ones, the militants, the other day gave out their own guns. And some other ones came back to the society. We'll talk more about that. But let me go to you, Mojeed. What's happening? It seems it's no big deal now when people lose their lives in this country.
We have a serious security situation on our hands. And it's like the government lacks the capacity to deal with the situation. And like Femi said, you have Boko Haram, you have cattle rustlers.
That Boko Haram,
you have cattle rustlers is even different from herdsmen.
Yes.
The cattle rustlers are after herdsmen. Herdsmen are after farmers. So then you have the militants. Mm-hmm. Then you have IPOB. I mean, in a country where even on a normal day we are under funded, mm-hmm. and we don't have. If you look at the per capita of security men to the number of Nigerians, we have less than 500,000 combined force of the security forces, security agencies, to 160 million or thereabouts. So you see the situation in Zamfara. I mean, about 3 local governments were affected, 25 people dead, about 740 people kidnapped, and these gunmen came, I mean, about 70 of them. They didn't come at night, they came at 3 p.m.
3 p.m.
So, and there was no immediate response to repel the attack. And you could recall that since we had changed the since we took back these 21 Chibok girls, there has been an upsurge in the rate of attacks, which suggests that probably the money they got, or rather whatever they got in exchange, was used to arm themselves. Suddenly the Chekau that has been declared dead several times has now also been declared wanted again. I mean, it's now on the wanted list.
There is the dead Chekau that is wanted.
It's now on the dead on the most wanted criminal list of our military. The same military showed us pictures. It's like we don't have the capacity to combat it. I think we should seek help. Honestly,
we even have kidnappers on the prowl.
We have kidnappers. So it's like a barrage of attacks coming from all angles. I mean, you can't say we are safe in the Southwest. The Talai was kidnapped in the Southwest. A lot of people have been kidnapped. The former minister, Yabo Anishilowo, was kidnapped in the Southwest.
Yeah, relatively speaking, so, in terms of the magnanimity of
it. Lufa Lai was also kidnapped in the Southwest.
There's a serious security problem. Yes. And this, you can relate this to the state of the economy.
Okay.
The economy is really bad, and people must earn a living. And you see, we really need to sit down and talk about the security, the insurgents, this the upsurge in these attacks.
And that's as soon as possible.
As soon as it's practical.
All right. We need to go on a short break. While we'll come back, we'll continue with the conversation. Don't go anywhere, please. Welcome back. You're still watching Journalist Hangouts. Atabia, I now go to you with a question I wanted to ask initially. I cited an example of the last time where they were dropping arms and ammunition in River State. And it's almost like double of the quantity that was dropped some few years ago. We recovered again from these young men. Where did these arms come in? Like, it's embarrassing, don't you think?
Oh, definitely. And the unfortunate thing is it will keep happening because nothing is being done to tackle the root causes. You know, in Nigeria, we're fond of looking at the symptoms of a problem without going to what is really causing that problem. Earlier, I said a lot of these issues are 20, 30 years in the making. You have states in the north that are basically failed states. You know, they're quite honestly, if we're to be frank, they do not function any better than what you see in the Sudan or Somalia. You know, governments exist on paper, but in reality, they have no control over their territories in terms of, as we said earlier, 350 million illegal small arms. That means that basically every other person, every other Nigerian has at their disposal, you know, the kind of weapons that you do not find readily available in most other countries. So population really isn't an excuse in saying that there are so many people that you can't possibly control. That's absolutely not true. We need to look at root causes, poverty. You know, if they say in political science that if you look at the correlation between infrastructure development and security issues, you find that the two go hand in hand. The less you invest in an area, the more likely you are to see this kind of issues happening. Because as you said, people need to make a living. And what is the easiest way? Unfortunately, it's criminal, it's crime. Crime does pay, especially in our environments. When you see that, when you kidnap and you ask for a ransom, people pay.
That's when they've not been caught.
You know, the Americans have this saying, you don't dialogue with terrorists. It's for a reason. You know, we keep raising the stakes and giving people more and more of an incentive to do these things without correcting the root causes of all of these issues. So unfortunately, it will keep occurring till we decide to finally take a decisive, you know, stand and say that it just is not normal in a so-called democracy that women, children, individuals, young people, old people are not safe. You can wake up one morning and your village is burnt to the ground, wiped out, and nothing is done. It's absolutely sad. Unacceptable.
Good evening, Lukman. You're calling from Kaduna.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Hello?
Yes, I'm waiting. We are waiting for your contribution, please.
Hello?
Hello, Lukman. You're live.
Yes, please.
Your contribution, please.
Okay. Good evening.
Good evening.
In my opinion, the truth of the matter is, hello? Like I said, the truth of the matter, in my own opinion, is, yeah. Good evening.
All right, look, man, next time when you call in, don't listen to yourself. Just keep on talking whenever you hear my voice. But thank you very much. And let me go to you, sir, because she was saying if it's easy for everyone to just get guns, like even the ones, the kidnappers, and maybe they don't see enough punishment, really, for them to think, if I have guns with me, it's a very big deal. Because some people nowadays just have guns, and you know, at the end of the day, maybe the government, after using them, I mean, the ones that use them to enter into government, after using and dumping them, later on they just call them, okay guys, bring your arms now, I give amnesty. Is that the way forward, or you just punish anybody you see illegal arms with?
Well, we should know by now that we are Nigerians. Laws are observed in the breach, you know, in this country more than anywhere in the world. And as you have legal arms, you know, so you have, you know, other illegalities going on. That is saying that we have a society that is really failing, you know. if not a failed state. Ms. Prince will mention the fact that some states in the north are actually a failed state. You know, I couldn't really agree more. You know, we can actually say that Nigeria is a failing state because of the fact that there's really no indices of human development. There's really no indices of social development that we have a good handle on. You know, you can.
I have a caller from Kaduna again, but sure. I'll come back to you after Hello. That. And that's Tosin. Good evening, Tosin.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
I'm Tosin from Kaduna.
Okay. You're welcome, Tosin.
Yeah, my contribution on that issue. You cannot give what you don't have. I believe our security agencies, maybe it's because they are not up to task, or they don't have enough weapons, or the government of the day is not able to help matters. So I think something has to be done in that line. We should wake up to security issues in this country. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Tosin. I did interrupt you.
Yeah, that's all right. The bottom line of all these that were in my own estimation, is that this country needs to be taken apart, you know, and be rebuilt. What I mean by that is that the fundamental, you know, structure that defines a country and that defines what we want to be and who we want to be and how we want to live our lives as an entity is pretty much absent. You know, until we go into that fundamental, just as Ms. Prince would say, until we go into that fundamental, and that means that the entire constitutional structure that's set it up, that says that, you know, you cannot have a police, you know, in any state, that the police can have to come from the center. These are all structures that are moribund, outdated, that is never
are you saying like vigilante structures could help out in helping
in my own opinion, any little thing that will mitigate all of this, you know, let's forget about all these things that have been happening, but that has not been working, you know, for decades. If things have not been working for decades, why continue to do the same thing? You know, they say, you know, it is the height of insanity when you do the same thing and expect, you know, different results. And this is basically what this country has been doing in its entirety.
From Kano State, I have Useni. Good evening, Useni. I will last that call there. So, Majid, what do you think? How do we mop up? And you cited the example or instance whereby we can even have state, we can police state-wise.
I think the states should borrow a leaf from the Lagos State example, where the Lagos State governor has spent a lot on security and it's actually working. On the last count, about between 6 and 7 billion has been spent on equipping the security agencies in the last, the rapid response called the LRU and some other. The rescue units, and so many others, and I think it's working. Most of these crimes, when they are committed, you see that they get caught in most cases, especially the kidnap cases. But then,
The Lagos situation is working because, for the simple reason that Lagos has a very deep pocket.
Yeah, even
most of these states do not have any money.
Most of those states in the north. What do they spend their security votes on, for example?
Exactly.
What do they spend it on?
Can I quickly take Nura from Kano, right?
They can afford to.
Good evening, Nura.
Yes, thank you.
Nura, are you still there? Good evening. From Zamfara, Nura.
Yeah, thank you.
How are you, sir? What's happening in your state?
Exactly what is happening there. There's an episode that occurred somewhere around a local government. Gunmen attacked some villagers and killed them.
We heard the death toll is around 139 people.
Exactly.
So what do you think the security agents are doing to protect you people there?
From my own side, there is There is no tied security.
There's no what?
There is no tied security.
No tied security.
The authority will attend the post people to go and there is no prevention.
No prevention, right? What did he say?
There is no
prevention. Because Nura, because some people said maybe some people had an idea this thing will happen because some cattle were collected from these people and they came back for it or something like that. Is that the story?
Hello?
Nura. Some people said yeah. they knew this was coming and the security agents didn't see it coming.
So I cannot argue with them too. I cannot argue with them. But my one belief or understand is that it is after and has operated their intention, then the authority will arrive.
Okay. Yeah, they should be there before then, right?
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Nura. Nura takes us to that break. And when journalists hang out, returns, Mark Alfie faction of PDP wants Ondo governorship election are postponed and details after this time out. Please stay with us. Welcome back. I'll let them finish first. I'll get a conclusion before we go to the next topic. Bajid, the way forward.
Yeah, as it is. Now we are under-policed. Apart from that, they are ill-equipped, and that's why you see our soldiers running away from the battlefront, and they will tell you it's a tactical maneuver. So we need to increase the. I think there was a time the National Assembly actually suggested that we should increase the number of recruitment into the. As various security agencies. I don't think that has been done. We need to, less than 500,000 security men to 160 million people is way below the UN standards. So I think we need to get more people into the security agencies.
All right, Tabi, way out.
Well, I think we need to really look at our mindset, you know, because for me, it's not just about hiring more people, it's the kind of people you hire as well. A lot of our security operatives are not graduates. They cannot conceptualize strategy to plan because these guys, the way they operate, they have tactical, they are doing things with the kind of military precision you wonder.
And our police should be a step ahead of them.
But they're not, you know. So the training and hiring graduates, making these careers attractive to such people.
All right, what do you think?
Well, what I think therefore is that there should be a sort of a very radical surgery that must begin to take place in the structure of this country as soon as possible. Rather than treating what I would consider mundane things, you know, by the National Assembly, we are just carrying on as if nothing is happening.
Exactly.
You know, so national emergency, an activist government, you know, which you know Buhari is trying to be. But unfortunately, the other two arms of government are not interested. Okay. Should be the in thing.
Okay, we need to go to Ondo now because barely 6 days to the governorship election, Senator Ahmed Markafe-led National Caretaker Committee, a faction of the People's Democratic Party, has called on the Independent National Electoral Commission (INEC) to postpone it. The faction said the election should hold after the court has determined the true candidate of the party. But the Independent National Electoral Commission, INEC, has dismissed the call. On Sunday, the resident electoral commissioner for Ondo State, Olusegun Agbaje, said the body has finalized preparations and it won't be ideal to postpone the poll because of one party. Does this faction have a choice, really? Is Agbaje not making sense there? Can we still postpone this election?
Well, I think... as at Friday, INEC said it was ready for the election, and that there is except there is. I mean, I listened to one of the national commissioners of INEC. I can't recall his name now, and he said there is no need for any postponement. That they are ready.
You just came back from Accra, right?
Yes, I just came back from Accra, and it's like. Yeah, Agbaje is the resident electoral commissioner.
Commissioner there.
In Ondo State.
Ondo State.
And they have it. Yeah, Shoyebi is a national electoral commissioner in charge of the whole of the Southwest.
Southwest.
So he addressed a press conference on Friday where he said INEC is ready. And funny enough, today it is the Sherif faction that has the candidate as we speak. The Sherif faction has Jimmy Ibrahim as their candidate, and they are saying they are ready for the election. But McAlfey has Jegede as its own Jegede as its own candidate. They are saying they are not ready, that the election should be postponed until there is a court ruling. But then I think they should be reminded that if there is an El Clasico between Barcelona and Real Madrid, and Messi is injured. El Clasico will not be postponed. So we are going to have an El Clasico in Ondo State on Saturday. So Barcelona will have to live with the luxury or otherwise of playing without a Messi in a very crucial.
And hopefully maybe they might win.
And they might win. Okay. I mean, it happened to Ronaldo.
But the problem, if the team wants to go without Messi.
Yeah.
But now the team is saying they don't even want the play. Other player.
I think they
don't want to play. Is that?
You see, no, I think the what we have on ground in Ondo today is, I recall that somebody, we were speaking, I interacted with a lot of people as a journalist, and they said there are 28
political parties
for this election. That the PDP invited trouble into its own house. It's an in-house thing. So now it's not as if they don't have a candidate at all. They have a candidate, but they are saying it's not from the right faction. They call that it was Wike of Rivers and Fayose of Ekiti State that went to invite Sherif to come. And the man came in, and I said it then that, you see, you have 12 governors. This guy has 24 states that has no governors. And he funded those 24 states.
Mm-hmm.
So he emerged. He was able to have the structure. And you see, let them know now that until that June 29 verdict is reversed, the same thing, it is the Sherif faction that will take control of all the states in the Southwest, PDP.
Even Ekiti also.
Ekiti, Osun.
Oyo,
Ogun. It is the Sherif faction as of today until that verdict is reversed. So I am I'm giving them free consultancy now that they should go and reverse that judgment. If they don't do so, it is Sherif that will hold sway.
Tabia, what do you think the interpretation of what's going on? Because apparently they're protesting Akure today, and they're saying, some of them are saying, the APC-led government should not use the instrument of the judiciary to change everything, because they're saying all that is happening is just the APC that does not want Eyitayo Jegede to contest, because if they know that if he tries to contest, he will win.
You know, a lot of these issues are non-issues. Non-issues because they concern only the political class and not even the people who are going to be voting, you know. Because whether A or B, the situation in Nigeria remains the same, you know. But then the real question here is, how come, you know, you have countries like France, the Conservative Party there is holding its primaries. A former president, Sarkozy, lost out, you know. You didn't hear him come out and say, I need to go to this tribunal to reverse whatever.
Yeah.
He accepted and he's retiring. He's, you know, finding whatever it is he will do after office. He didn't come and say this or that, as we've seen with this whole saga of different factions and whatever. You know, this mentality of, if it can't be me, it can't be you, and being a spoiler is, you know, one of our biggest problems in this country. And it doesn't pay. It doesn't pay, even the people protesting, it doesn't pay them in the end. Because after this protest, when whoever wins, they're not going to come back and look at who was protesting for me or whatever. They will go in there and do what they want.
Mm.
So it's up to Nigerians to get smart and stop allowing themselves to be used by people who have no interest whatsoever in their welfare. You know, these are not issues that people sit around and discuss in other countries. You know, in real democracies, societies that respect the rule of law.
You know,
judgment has been given. Still debating?
Yeah, these issues really have marked the whole essential of what election is about. people have refused to hack the electorate, have refused to hack the people. What do you have for us? I think people now, all that is happening now has really formed like a cloud on the essentials of this election. What do you think?
Well, let me start by saying that by agreeing with Ms. Princewell that it's really a non-issue, but unfortunately it is an issue.
Because it is
defined as a issue, as an issue because of the political class, you know, because of the system, you know, that says it is such. Having said that, I've been around long enough in this country now to say it is not over until the fat lady sings. As much as I do believe that it is a non-issue, because a PDP candidate is already on ground, and that is all INEC needs, you know, to go ahead with the election. But who's to say that tomorrow some court would not say, you know what, we are stopping this for some reason. And you know, INEC already said that they are going to go by the court. You know, I don't even know why they are not even saying that. We have our own rule, you know. If what the political parties are doing does not tally with our own rule, we have a responsibility, you know, to step in. But INEC, unfortunately, it seems to me, is trying to play safe, you know, in
isn't
some instances.
Better? Because
you
know, it's independent, isn't it?
Yeah, but then in some situations, you don't necessarily have to play safe. You know, you have to be assertive, exactly. You know, in some situations too. You know, because we are talking
the last
about...
Last time I wanted to be assertive, you remember Jim O'Brien said... they tried to collect some millions of naira from him. I think that's why they're trying to place him.
$1 million. See, again, that's you know, that is, you know, that is the thing. But you know, I just came from Akure, just like
Yamil,
you know, so I'll be going back tomorrow again, just to be on ground to continue to observe things. But as far as this thing is concerned, we never can tell.
Anything
can still happen, you know.
Jegere is still insisting he will contest in this election.
He's still insisting.
The guy is so sure.
But you know, we need to ask ourselves how is that
really?
Even possible?
Can something happen?
See, let's paint a scenario now.
Okay.
The Supreme Court has a ruling tomorrow, so to say, Tuesday. Even if the Supreme Court rules today, worst case scenario, they will say, go back to the appellate courts, and the appellate court will now probably sit on Wednesday and allow Jegede to be joined in the primary suit, not a ruling.
Yes.
So that is why, for example, they are asking for a postponement, because they know that even if the process is fast-tracked at the court, 6 days is too short for them to get a ruling. So they know that even if they get a ruling, it won't
But to get a ruling in a Nigerian court of like, except there's an exemption.
No, that's what I'm saying, that if they do this ex parte motion, but then there is a subsisting judgment. An ex parte motion cannot override a subsisting judgment, which because it has a lifespan. So it's, I don't know where, because as we speak in Akure or in Ondo State today, Jegede is campaigning.
Yes.
He just appointed coordinators for all the 18 local governments for his campaign yesterday. And Jimo Ibrahim is also campaigning. So we have two characters in PDP.
And anything can happen.
Campaigning. But then, with INEC, Jimo Ibrahim is there.
The candidate. Okay, we need to go on yet another break. And when we come back, we'll continue again. That's great. So welcome back. Gentlemen, as we round up this part, before we go to the third part, what do you think? The visit of the president, the rally yesterday, the president was around yesterday, on Saturday. And again, we need to talk about this because it's been APC, PDP all the way. Shouldn't we look at this gentleman called Oki? He might pull a Trump card, don't you think?
Well, the truth of the matter is our campaigning in this country is still very rudimentary. you know, none of the platforms are different, if not for the names of their flag bearers. You know, nobody really knows what do they stand for, who are they, what are their plans. If you knew their plans, then even the delegates themselves, when voting for the candidates, would know that, okay, this is the person that we really want. There would be less intervention or allegations of influence from Mr. A or Mr. B if everybody stood for something and we all clearly knew what this person is about. Mm-hmm. You know, so for me, that still remains the biggest issue, and it's unfortunate that that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about personalities as opposed to policies, yes. Which is why we keep seeing these things playing and happening over and over and over again. Different people, different problem, but you know, it's still sadly the same for the yes. average man on the streets, because we don't talk about what really matters.
Femi, what do you think? The visit of the president is on Saturday. Well, did that change anything? Or
well, I haven't talked about whether or not the election should be postponed. It's pretty much going to be between Akeredolu and Oke. And from observing and talking to people, the grand finale on Saturday that the president came and some of the officials of government changed the dynamic of the Akeredolu campaign. To the positive, that is, it is pretty much looking like it is an election. It is an election for Akeredolu to lose, rather than the other way around. Now, that is not to say that Oke cannot pull any surprise, because the man is a hard campaigner. The man is a grassroots mobilizer.
So anything can happen.
Anything can still happen. Mm-hmm. You know, but it is going to be between the two of them.
All right. Yeah. What do you think?
Yes, I think I'll toe the line of Femi here. You see, there was a first rally, the flag of the APC, where the principal officers of the party didn't show up. I mean, the president was not there, the VP was not there. And okay, lashed in on that.
Yes.
To say that the Akeredolu APC team has no support of the federal government, and that they can see that, I mean, he left the party and a lot of people are with him from the APC. But like Femi said, the dynamics changed on Saturday when the president came. The president came into the campaign arena wearing his Malam cap, but when he got to the stage, he wore Akeredolu cap. And he said very key words, few though. He said, Akiti emerged through a very transparent primary.
That's what he said.
And that Akiti will win the election. So you already see the direction of the president. And that has thrown serious panners in the works of the OK team. But that is not to say that it's not going to be an open contest. I think it's an open contest that could go either way. But then it's between two parties, like you said, APC and AD.
And AD.
It's a no contest for
PDP.
PDP is not in the race.
Okay, thank you so much. And moving on, President Muhammadu Buhari has appealed out to the people of Niger Delta to embrace peace, stop the destruction of pipeline, and focus on agriculture for sustainable economic development. He said that destroying pipeline is doing not just a great damage to the economy, it is degrading the environment. These appeals sound great, but it brings to question the ongoing peace talk between the government and the leaders of the Niger Delta region. Is this government talking to the right people? And let me just go to you, Tavia, because are they talking to the right people, your people?
My people, you say. You say.
There are people too.
They are all Nigerians. But no, quite frankly, no. They're definitely not, you know. First things first, when the so-called elders or leaders of Niger Delta came to the presidency, when was it? About 10 days or so ago, in their list of demands, you could clearly see that they were not there to talk for the common man, you know, asking for oil blocks and all of that. That doesn't benefit the common man, that benefits them, political interests, you know. So it's unfortunate that this appeal, you know, is, it's, you know, I hate to sound pessimistic, but it's not going to work. You don't appeal to the conscience of criminals, because if they had any conscience, they would know that the people that suffer from pipeline damage and oil spills are poor people, not rich people, you know. And so if they cared at all about the livelihood of their fellow countrymen, they wouldn't do that in the first place because no one else suffers but them. But the other thing is, you know, we have to, like I said earlier, the root causes of issues. Had we been developing all of these regions and moving at the same pace as our counterparts who discovered oil at the same time as us, we would not be here, you know. We need to, and you know, again, we need to be honest with ourselves, particularly people in the Niger Delta, and hold our leaders to account. And by our leaders, I mean people, you know, across board in Nigeria. You look at agencies like the NDDC, NIMASA, and all of that, and you look at the huge budgets in billions of foreign currency that they have year in, year out, yet nothing changes for the common man. Then you hear people carrying placards and saying, leave, L-I-V-E, so-and-so person alone. Meanwhile, what has that person done for you? Then you start shouting, it doesn't matter, he's my brother, whatever. No, you know, it's all these ancient mindsets that do nothing for us, but yet we insist on carrying on with them. So again, unfortunate, but a call for peace when they have no reason to be peaceful. And then again, the people themselves.
So do you think the military force should be continued?
The military force unfortunately needs to continue because you cannot dialogue with people who are criminals and who have criminal intent. But I think the real appeal should be to the mothers, the sisters, the daughters of the militants who know these people, because terrorists and militants don't operate in a vacuum. They go home at whatever point to wives, girlfriends and all that, who know who they are and can identify
and
them, but they never do. We all protect crime in Nigeria. That's
right. What do you think? The president said they should go back to agriculture, but that's the one that really caught my attention, really. What kind of agriculture? Is it pastoral or which one now? Because where do they have to farm?
Well, to me, it sounds good that the president said they should go back to agriculture. But as you say, as far as they are concerned, I don't even think they are listening to the president to begin with anyway. Because if they are listening to it, if they have been listening to him, they wouldn't have even started what they, you know, what they started with.
Even after the dialogue or with the chiefs.
The Niger Delta, and one has to be very careful. As much as I'm willing to blame, and I should blame, all these militants, because they have expressed that it is really, it is not about the development of the area in the final analysis. It is their own pocket, you know. And after all, they have said, you know, in the whole world that they should leave Tompolo, you know. They should leave any Niger Delta that has been identified
the measure
as
that's
corrupt, you know, alone. And you have to begin to ask yourself, what is in their mentality? You know, you have somebody like Tompolo, who is a stark illiterate, you know, who has been accused of 30 something billions of naira embezzlement. I never denied it. The man is riding a private jet, you know, and nobody is questioning, you know, how we got all this money. And what was left for you was to start blowing, you know, the very resource that could potentially be used to change the way of life of your people. Then you have to begin to wonder, what kind of mindset do these people have, you know? So at the end of the day, what is happening now is the nonchalance, the I don't care attitude, the you know, you people can go to places, you know, of government over the years.
So you think the government should still continue pleading with these people or continue with the use of force?
Well, I think I've said it in one of these programs before, that as much as I believe in carrot and stick approach, I think it is quite clear now that the stick should be used more
than the carrots.
Than the carrots.
Okay, Majid, what do you think? And again, let's put that agriculture thing beside it. Really, is it achievable over there?
Yeah, I think we need to understand the context with which the president is pleading to and making that plea to the militants to go back to the farm. It was represented by the Minister of State for Agri, Anakin Lokobere, where the Nigerian Agri, Nigerian Agip Oil Company is giving out a farm support program to its host community. And I mean, it made the statement that the ministers should rather see farming as a lucrative business rather than blowing pipelines. But then these characters are used to free money. And
but he said, why don't we appease to the women, the mothers and the sisters? Because if you have a shipping, I mean, a fishing trawler around you give the women a whole lot to do. They will beg the boys. Take it easy, guys.
They are all in this together. They are used to free money. You need to see the kind of livelihood Tompolo engages in. He lives in a palace. He empowers a lot of people. He gives them free money. They come to his house to eat. So
they think that's life.
Nobody goes to the farm again. Nobody goes to fish. So they see him as he's like a lord in his community at Grimatu. So it will be difficult for them to go back to farm. Because farming is not something you plan to do on a different day. But with militancy, they blow
you make
pipeline.
Money.
They make money. They have private refineries. They go private refineries where they make money from.
Wow.
What they hijack vessels, pirate vessels, and sell meat.
Quick
and
money.
And they collect cash. Mm. So you can appeal to them to go and start farming.
I wonder.
You plant maize, corn, or what? This can't work for them.
We will try cassava. Thank you so much, Majid Jamiu, for coming again to the FEMI Odiri.
Thank you
so much, Tabia Princewood.
Thank you.
Thank you also. And that's all in Journalist Hangout. For those that have called, thank you so much. Join us tomorrow for another exciting episode of our program. You can also watch Journalist Hangout on YouTube at youtube.com/TVC News Nigeria. Our feedback channel is Journalist Hangout at tvcnews.tv. I am Dapo Aruwaje. Bye for now. God bless Nigeria.